Hello everybody, and welcome back to the New Dimension Racing GT1 World Series 24 Hours of KY3. We're 10 and a half hours in. Currently in the commentary box with me is Safety Car Steve, and also still in deep discussion about sim racing is Pinalas from Hellenic Racing Team, our current GTM leaders. So, return to the conversation about sims. You are right, it's difficult to argue with people when they say, oh, but iRacing's too expensive. I mean, it just is. The cost of cars, the cost of tracks, and the subscription itself, that's not something you have to contend with in other sims.
Yeah, I mean, I used to say that I was willing to pay the devs of LFS anything for a nice history release with new tracks, new cars, all that. And I resisted iRacing for a long, long time. Scared by the pricing and also the fact that we didn't run it as a team and I didn't want to be running it on my own. But if you can afford it, it's really good. It's lots of fun. And it feels fantastic, it looks fantastic, it sounds amazing.
The recent update's done a lot for the sound package that they've got. And particularly with things like the V8 Supercar, which now sounds better than anything else in sim racing.
Yeah, it does, absolutely. I think they posted a video about it and I watched it and it was just awesome. I like V8s.
Indeed. And you also spoke briefly about Assetto Corsa, which is one of those sims that's in development as such. Another big one that's in development in its open beta, well, I say open, it's not really, but closed beta as such, is RFAT 2, and I don't know if you've delved into that at all.
No, not at all. I did try RFAT 2 at some point, the first one, and it was nice, but the stupid thing about it was that everybody was just creating cars and tracks. Some of them were good, others were just plain bullshit, and that kind of made it feel wrong. And it was complicated for me to just join a server with buddies and race. LFS makes that way better, easier. All you have to do is have a host that hosts your server, which, as far as I understand, is pretty difficult right now in LFS.
Yeah, well, it makes it all the more impressive that the server's been as stable as it has been.
Where is this server hosted? Does anybody, what kind of server is this we're racing on? It's been very stable for them.
I believe, and Jonathan Palmer is more than welcome to whisper in my ear and correct me, that New Dimension Racing has moved from 500 servers to an American provider now. I know. I stand corrected. This is actually same server location for as the car game servers.
Okay.
In Live for Speed.
So it's probably in Holland somewhere. Netherlands, I should say.
Yeah. Raubikes or something. As Deco's so adequately put it to me there.
Yeah, America wouldn't really make sense because I had like 50 milliseconds of ping and I'm in Germany. So yes. I'm good. The others are like 100 or something like that.
Oh, your car is currently entering the pit lane with a flat tyre.
Oh, I didn't realise.
Looks like you got lucky there and actually got the flat tyre at the end of the lap and avoided any damage or hitting of walls.
Yeah, I'm watching him all the time on the remote and it looked like he was going alright. His second split was a 31-39, so
yeah.
It was somewhere at the end of the stint. That's a good calculation then.
Yeah, marginal. I believe also you're about to lose the lead of Am. Are you? No, you're a lap ahead. Ignore me. The rest of Am is just unlapping itself from you.
Yeah, I guess we're good there. And Almas is very quick. He's going to make sure we stay where we are. Yeah, Yeah, it looks all right.
So yeah, you've you've still got the lead by near enough a lap.
I haven't really had enough time to just sort out how much gap there is between us and the second placed M car, because there's two pros in between, and I don't know, you'd have to add all the differences together in the track, I believe, so you get a clean readout of how much the gap is.
Well, I can guesstimate the gap for you. I have a good guess. It's about 2 minutes at the moment. Is your gap second in class?
I don't know if my tracker is way back, because right now my tracker says that the number 12 car is one lap down from the number 9 car. These are the two pros. That means...
No, I don't believe that that's quite right.
Let me try and re...
From my understanding is that now the top three in AM are on the same lap, but the Hellenic racing car, so your car, is relatively close behind those other two. So, like I say, right, about 15 seconds back from Boros, who is second in class.
So why does the 12 car say two laps, well, one lap, it says two now because it's probably just the overlap. It says that the gap between number 12 and number 9 is one lap. So if they already have a lap in between them as a gap, should we have more in comparison to number 54, who's the second in AM? I'm not sure. We know that it's a big gap, so we don't really... at least I didn't have time to think of that. I was too busy checking the phone and everything.
Yeah, I wouldn't worry. I think it's definitely between 90 seconds to 2 minutes at the moment. So a healthy lead, it's fair to say. Everyone's quite spread out at the moment, come to think of it. No one's really very close to anyone else.
Yeah, and Alvarez just recently moved to Australia, so he's racing from there now. He did a lot of testing on the server the weeks before the race and had no issues. I hope it stays that way. It would be a pity if something happens.
It would be unfortunate. I mean, if you timed out just as you started a lap, you would hold on to the lead most probably. But at the same time, you don't want to put yourself in a position where you actually have to physically start racing people for the position that you're in.
We were talking about this with Nico, and he said it was something like, if you drop out at the end of this the lap, it's like 5 minutes lost, which is insane.
Yeah.
I don't know if I understood him correct, but I think he said that the outlap somehow doesn't go into the tracker if you lag out and rejoin.
Yeah, I've never been 100% sure on the ruling for that one, but I believe that it's more beneficial to time out as you go over the start and finish line than just before it.
There's been very few disconnects. I believe everybody's still running, right? No flips, nothing?
No, there's been one retirement who I cannot remember for the life of me who it is. Car 74. And that's a Merida racing team. They've DNF'd. Unfortunately, the team that I'm a part of, Infinity Esports, they've had a couple of timeouts. But you're right, everyone's still going fairly well, and there haven't been many timeouts, and only the one retirement, and yeah, 10.5 hours, 10.75 hours into a race, so very good so far.
Yeah, I mean, you tend to forget that it's not that late, isn't it? There's still so much to go.
So you've still got 13 hours and 20 minutes, yeah. It's a long race, and it's this sort of time period now when you've done, you know, nearly double what you normally do in an endurance race. and you're thinking, what, and I'm not halfway yet. I think that was very interesting. And, you know, the following hours, the 12 through 18, they're the tough ones where everyone's tired and out of it, just trying to hold the car together for a bit longer.
As I said, Almanac is in Australia now, so that means it's what time is in Australia? It should be something like...
must be about lunchtime.
Yes, midday. So, you know, that's a good thing. And our other driver has been sleeping during the evening, so he's fresh and good to go for the night run.
So you've got it fairly planned out for you here.
We've had luck because in the past it was hard to really get six drivers to do the training that you have to do to be able to compete in a 24-hour event. You need to do a lot of laps, I do. I know some people that say they just do two or three stints and then they join the race, but that would be too much for me. I need to be sure that I can run the car without... just planting it in a wall or something like that. Especially here where you're not allowed to rejoin. And this time it was six drivers, including me, six. And if everything goes well, only five will be racing, and I'll be the sixth one. And, well, you know, you can cut it into three parts of 8 hours. Two drivers do the first 8 hours, and then it goes on and on. And the others can sleep, get some rest. At the end, it's probably good to know what's going on there.
Oh, and third place in your class has gone off in turn one. Matt King's in the...
yeah, that's left.
LMM car. It's unfortunate for them.
They've been unlucky, I believe. They said they smashed the engine in the first hour.
Yeah, but they didn't. The car checked it and their engine was fine.
Oh, okay.
That is still the case. They're not losing out to anyone else in terms of straight line speed. No, certainly not you, because your FXR is not very quick anyway.
So basically, to give you an idea of what the roads are, except for driving, of course, George, the guy racing right now, is usually the one who will do the strategy. There's one guy whose name is Kostas Yagias, who never really raced with us in the events, but he's always there. And he knows a lot of Excel stuff, so he helps us out with the calculation on that. And he's been here all night, so he's helping on the support side, so am I. And the others you've seen, Nestoras and Peres, are both racing, of course, helping out as much as they can, trying to be on standby in case something happens and somebody loses his connection. And so it's basically, yeah, five drivers and me, I'm the sixth driver, I'm helping out with race, and one more guy for support, which is Jose Diaz. I was always thinking I need to give you a manual of Greek names so you can pronounce them right on the track.
Yeah, well, in all fairness, we just need a manual for every name that's not British or American. Because, you know, generally speaking, everyone in the commentary box is rubbish at names.
Well, I mean, I guess it's hard to find the pronunciation, also the letter you need to put the tone on. So basically it's Alamaras, and most of the comments guys are going to say Almaras, something like that.
Yeah, me included. No, you're right, and again, with the Greek language, you've got lots of different accents and letters and all sorts, and they're just there to confuse me because I've got no idea.
I think there's actually an option of writing in Greek characters in LFS your name, but I think they won't allow us to do that. That would be fun, because then you'd have no idea what your name is.
They don't like to do that, because then we're just going to go every time we have to say the driver's name, because we won't know.
Maybe we'll do that one day, just for fun.
Yeah, just one race.
Just so we get a drive-through by vehicle.
Maybe you should do that next time out at South City, just to make it fair on everyone else.
I'm really looking forward to Cell City because I know these guys are eager to race and they're very quick with the FXR. And I think it's also a track that favors us, at least more than Kyoto does, but Kyoto doesn't favor us. Anyway.
No, South City is an FXR track. It's built for your car. Just the slow speed corners everywhere is perfect for an FXR. Just four-wheel drive your way past everybody on the exits.
Well, there is no real room for overtake, is there? In Sound City.
No, although, oh, and we've lost one of our front runners. That's Kresma, Terra Mine Factory. Hopefully they can get themselves back in quickly.
They've been in fifth, right?
Yeah, they're just had their pit stop, so I'm not sure. Are they still on track? Yeah, I think they are.
It's been such a tight battle in at the front in Pro Amazing. I don't know how many hours they were, like, within 3 seconds.
The vast majority of the first 9 hours, really. And they've sort of spread out over the last two.
You know, it's I always hate that. You never really have time when you're racing. You never really have time to watch the stream. I always have it just silent enough so I can hear what you're saying, but I never really make anything up unless the word Hellenic Racing Team comes in. Oh, they're talking about us, and then I'll watch it a little bit. But otherwise, it's just running in the background, and I can't really never watch what's going on because I'm so busy with other stuff.
Yeah, what? When you're running a team for a 24-hour race, it's always good to be busy with other stuff because it's a lot of work to get, like you say, enough people in one place at one time to actually drive a car for 24 hours and then make sure you've got people on backup for if the internet goes. And there's a lot of different variables and angles to cover. And I respect that. I mean, I've never been anything more than a driver in very long endurance races. I've never really organised a team or thought about strategy and whatnot. I just get told when I turn the car left and right and do my bit there.
Yeah, that's the most fun part, really. I mean, the micromanagement can be very fun as well. I enjoy it, especially since I haven't raced LFS for so long time now. And I'm not really looking forward to it because it feels so old and old-fashioned now that I'm kind of used to other things. But the really fun part is just being part of a team and just driving. I think that's the most fun part of it. Just having somebody in the team speak, telling you what the gaps are and stuff like that. Being under pressure all the time. I love the pressure. I love it when you really have to be 100% all the time.
Indeed, it seems that you're pulling off quite well by leading your class by quite as much as you are doing. Yeah, it's still about 2 minute gap that you've managed to get yourself on the rest of the AM field.
Yeah, I'm curious to see what the other drivers are going to do, because as far as I see here, two of the guys from the breeding program haven't raced yet. I don't know how quick these guys are. And also in LLM. Oh, no. In LLM, it's
we've got some Norby Kiss, I believe that is, has gone off.
There was contact there with Ray Kingsbury going into turn one, and I think...
Ray or Matt? Matt Osprey.
It was Ray. I'm fairly sure it was Ray.
Ray?
Yes, it was.
It could have been both of them. They're right together.
It was Matt.
Yeah, it showed up as Matt for me. That's all.
It was my mistake.
I understand why he made that mistake, but...
but Matt should have definitely... conceded space there and just left him because he was getting lapped. But instead he spun him round. Just not deliberately, but he spun him round.
So I've also got the first of the Asian drivers for Ixion in now. Again, I could have missed it earlier, but I think this is the first time. Got Chong joining to take over from Djakovic. Yeah, and there we are. Nicky in the pit lane. Ixie and Sim Sports still having a relatively strong showing this round. Anyway, I'd like to thank you very much for your input.
No problem, thanks for having me.
Sorry, what is your first name? Because I haven't got a clue.
Sorry, I should have made it clear. My name is Christos. It's a Greek name, which would probably be Chris in any other language other than Greek.
So, thank you very much for your input, Christos.
No, thank you for having me.
We all do genuinely wish the Hellenic Racing Team the best of luck in the rest of the race, because we would quite like to see an underdog car and a team that, like you say, hasn't really won any big endurance events yet go on to do well and win this one.
Yeah, let's hope for the best. Good luck for you guys commenting for the rest of the race.
Yeah, well, I'm thinking about taking my power nap now.
I'm sure you deserve that.
Well, possibly. You'll have to ask the other commentators on that one.
Okay, bye guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Right then, so joining us in the commentary box now is race director and head admin at New Dimension Racing, Jonathan Palmer.
Hello
Deco. Are you here to wipe my fevered brow and hold my sleepy head?
I was going to punch you in the face and knock you out for a few hours.
Yeah, that'll do it. One of the two, I'm not really first. So, seeing as everything is still quiet on the Western Front, on the track, how do you feel this event has gone as organiser?
I think it's going peachy and or keen.
It's quite good then. Only had the two safety car periods so far, I believe.
Yeah, we had two safety cars, but we did have three or four cars get stuck in the gravel, and we were fortunate to hot recover them. Mr. Jonathan Provost did most of those hot rescues, so thanks to him.
Dean, looks like you've been left near enough by yourself to run this race for the grueling night stint.
Yep, that's what I was actually kind of expecting. Figuring Thilo, with their loader, I decreed him as my second in command. So, you know, when I went for dinner a moment ago, he took over. When he comes back in a few hours, he can cover for me if I need to be absent for more than just a couple of minutes. But that's always the thing with the 24 hours, is getting people to help staff everything for the full 24. But even more so with us, since we have employed safety personnel, at least two or three people around for the, you know, one for a rescue car, one for a safety car, and at least one actual race director. So we've already automatically increased the staffing.
Yeah, because I remember that quite a lot of recent 24-hour races in Live Speed haven't actually had a safety car or rescue car system, so to speak.
Correct. It's pretty much always been that if you flip or you get stuck on the ground and can't get out, you can take a telepin, you know, shift B, shift S, you lose a lap, in addition to whatever time you lose. You know, they add a lap deduction to the tracker, but instead of having a safety car or any sort of push vehicles. Yeah, they have to go with that, but with this, if you get stuck, you have to wait for either yourself to mouse your way out or pull yourself out.
James Peace has just got a drive-through penalty. I would believe that was entering the pit lane.
It was. We got both our lead pair in the pits. We got NX and Zimvaris, and yes, James Peace has got a drive-through penalty for the number 2 Zimvaris Pro car. That's for speeding entering the pit lane.
Friskop's still going to retain the lead.
So, you know, I wanted to say this when I first came in, but I didn't have quite a decent chance. But to anyone watching from Europe, and not to anyone watching in the United States or any of the Americas, good evening. And to anyone watching happening to be in Asia, in Australasia, yes.
Oh, we've got the hell out of the car off.
Yeah, but actually none of the damper damages from that accident, he's just had that anyway.
Yeah, it's he all went straight in, he just went around like a top a few times.
It's all car, all visual damage. So hopefully he's not got anything dragging along the floor. He's obviously still perfectly safe in first position in class. Lost a arm and a leg to Borsos though in the stick reading program AMCAR. They could become a threat to Helena Gracing team in the next hour or two, but like we were just speaking about for the previous 20 minutes or so, Helena have got a really, really healthy gap.
The one thing that actually surprised me about this race was how hard people charged for the first several hours. Now, you know, I've been listening to you guys the whole time. It, you know, the first couple hours, it was just pretty much flat out like it was a sprint race.
Indeed. Well, I'm surprised that we didn't get safety cars sooner, to be honest. The amount of accidents that were actually going on.
I would have thought someone may have tried a little too early to push it at corner number 9 and flip on the curve at that point, you know, happened before, we've seen before. But, you know, I think chances of that might increase as we go on into the night and the rest of the morning as, you know, fatigue starts to kick in. Especially in the later part of the night when drivers have been alone for a few hours with most of their other teammates having rest, you know, offline. As Sean Lydon comes in to serve the penalty earned by James Peace.
Still no change of position there for Lydon and Vires. Just a time lost for Friskops.
What's kind of impressed you the most about the racing? The people in the racing car? I think we've already kind of sussed out that, you know, the FXR of Hellenic is quite impressive to you, but what else strikes you?
I'm still very impressed at the stick breeding program Pro Car, which obviously made a brave move from AM to Pro in the last couple of rounds, and is proving why they've made that move, because they're running top 5 for the Pro class consistently now, and that is in and of itself fantastic. I guess you could say stick breeding program just in general. I mean, known that they were newly formed for the beginning of this season, I believe, and they've just really been incredibly impressive every time that they've been out on the track. So they, for me, are a big point to think about. They're very talented, all of them, and very quick, and been getting results from day one. Ixion, they've actually calmed down. I think that's helping them. They're probably not as high up as they would want to be at the moment, but they've been driving with a better heads on their shoulders this time out than I've seen recently, and that's impressive. And minus the foolhardiness of the first 4 or 5 hours, that everyone's calming down now, and it's not really as silly, and everything seems to be working pretty well for everyone.
Very good. One thing in IRC, our just recent guests, is that Alamaros is LFS minimized for whatever reason, which is a unfortunate common plague in LFS.
Yeah, you do just get it from time to time.
That would have been a 4X in iRacing.
I think most of this race would have been a 4X in iRacing. But the nice thing is that that's not really in a bad way, because it's been rough racing, but no one's really causing issues. I mean, there's not really been a great number of avoidable contact protests, given the length that we've been racing as we just tipped the 11-hour mark.
Yeah, it's actually been fairly easy. Pretty much every single protest we've been through pretty quickly. There's just been a couple that have been a little more interesting, so we've been trying to get
Hell was that? Sean Liddon has just rammed Talent Racing Team off the track.
It was getting slightly held up by
frustrated
by side
or not, you can't just push
turn,
people out the way.
They're side by side through turn 9, and then Sheldon just had his horn on constantly after that, and then just gave a nudge into turn 10, and there's the FXR no choice but to go off.
Pretty poor show of driving quality there from someone who's been doing so well all day.
I have to agree with that, yeah.
Looks like a Helmut Racing Team now might have a bit of a scrape on the front of that car. And that's just completely obscene, so I hope that gets sorted out swiftly. Or at least looked at, anyway. Unfortunately, it's one of those things that you see far more often than you would want to in these races, and again, maybe even from one of the few drivers who we know are very quick, but it's also not uncommon for them to make rash moves such as that one.
So, Oscar, I know you've partaken in various long endurance events before.
A few.
So you have the experience of being a driver in said events and being part of said teams. And in fact, you were originally slated to drive at least an hour or two in this race.
I was indeed, but then they found someone more talented than me. I believe it's a quadruple amputee dog that's taken my place.
As I was about to say, it's not very hard to be more talented than you.
No. Just the AM team was short of a couple of drivers a few weeks ago, and I believe that problem just resolved itself. So they had no need for anybody as talentless as me to join in. That said, I think it's definitely for the better, because this is one of the best showings from the Infinity AM cars this season. Easily one of the best showings.
We've got a battle for second now between Sheldon and Dominic Engel. Dom, can I have a look at inside at the final corner? Yes. Gets it stopped and makes it stick for now, but Sean has the draft, he's got to use it most efficiently at the right time. if he's still got it, which he has.
Yeah, Dom doing a little bit of that quite nicely, actually.
Yeah, Dom doing a little bit of jinking to try and break the draft, but everyone's favorite Scouser gets around to reclaim P2.
But can he hold on to it? Dom's back in the slipstream. Very much so, and he goes to the outside for turn 3, and he gets past well before the braking zone. The position changes 3 times now, and it's Dominic Engel who's up to 2nd in the Genuine Racing car. Oh, and there's contact.
Oh, that's a bit of lag King. Contact from Sean onto the back of the Kingsbury car. And
I think the spiritual people like to call it karma.
I'm not going into that.
No, you're not allowed back to. You've got to be impartial.
I still think we're having that curse that whoever is in second or first will have some sort of misfortune. As seems to have been the case throughout the race so far.
Did it have? Right then, I'm going to leave all of you, the faithful viewers that are still with us at this time, God knows why, in the more than capable hands of Jonathan Palmer and Safety Car Steve for the remaining early hours of the morning, my time. Myself, and no doubt some of the other commentators you've heard so far this race, Chris Ford being one that I can actually remember at the moment, and possibly Michael Paxingham, I'm not sure. We'll be back later on to cover the remaining hours of this race. Thank you very much for joining myself up to now, and please enjoy the rest of the race and your company in the form of Deco and Steve.
Well, thank you, Mr. Hardwick. So yes, just past the 11-hour mark, so still just under 13 hours remaining, and I think it seems like we've already had almost 24 hours of action in the race so far in these first 11 hours.
Indeed, there's been lots of close fighting amongst a very evenly matched field up front, and there's been setbacks for a number of cars. One that comes to mind was Inex's first pit stop at the hour mark. Got a driving penalty, and there was a problem with the wheel. A number of cars had problems with the wheels, especially in the early stages of the race. But they've all managed to crawl themselves back onto fairly even ground, and we've got the top six within 2/3 of a lap of each other. We've got the top about 3 or 4 within a third of a lap, so it's still fairly close considering we've only had 2 safety cars so far in this 11 hours and 7 minutes so far. What's also been interesting with the guys up front is the way that the strategies have laid themselves out, primarily with the Genuine Racing car being almost exactly half a stint off kilter with the rest of the pack that they're competing with. Dominic Engel is in the car at the moment for Genuine Racing, and they'll be pitting within about in about 20 to 25 minutes ish for their next stop, whereas it'll be another 50 minutes at least until the next full round of pit stops for the likes of NX and Team Virus, who were in not too long ago.
Yep, it seems too that I haven't had much problem with lapping. Most of the lapping has been fairly clean.
Indeed, I mean, one of the main attributes that you would consider when it comes to an endurance race of this nature is multi-class aspects and dealing with traffic. But of course, here all cars are of GT1 category. There is a pro and am divide, but all machinery are at the same level. So you'd think that it would be more difficult lapping when it's your own, when it's similar machinery, because they're at a similar pace. Whereas if you're in say a GT1 car and you're lapping a GT2 or a GT3 car, then there's a considerable performance gap and it's easier to get past. So you're relying more on the cooperation of the other drivers to make sure that you can get past cleanly. I mean, obviously you're relying on the other cars giving you space and time if it's a slower car anyway, but it's just a different approach to how it's done in this sort of race. Yeah, there's not been much in the way of trouble. There was a couple of incidents lately, such as Matt King's with the Big Breeding Program Pro car into turn one, and also the trouble with the Hellenic FXR and Dawn Liddon up at turn 10 or turn 11, whatever number that is, the spoon curve it was referred to as earlier. But these incidents have been fairly few and far between as far as I can tell. Most of it, they've been pretty sensible.
One thing I'd like to mention to anyone watching, looks like we've got about 62 viewers right now. The first 8 hours of the stream are already available on the New Dimension Racing YouTube channel. That is youtube.com/user/LFSNDRTV. So yeah, the first 8 hours or so in those four parts are available there. The other few parts we generate during the European overnight will be ready to be uploaded to where I can get them as soon as our good friend Lutzinger at Simrace TV wakes from his sleep. He will upload those to the Simrace TV library, and then I will download them and try to have most of this race already on demand as quickly as possible. Up to and through the conclusion of this event. I would like to thank Mr. Ingrid and Simrace TV for the fantastic streaming platform. He's been a big help in getting everything set up. They recently, actually throughout this week, just had to switch to the Twitch TV platform for their stream after O3D became insolvent. So I had to change a few things and learn a few new tricks for that, but other than that, everything is going just swimmingly on our end. So, Steve.
Hello.
Seeing as I think it's a pretty quiet time, and, you know, one thing I kind of like to do when it's quiet like this, instead of just looking at some external cameras, I see we're already on an onboard, why don't we do a little thing where we get to just, watch some onboards for a few minutes?
Sure. Anyone in the field that you particularly fancy going on board with?
Why don't we start with the amateur class leaders of Hellenic Racing Team, currently piloted by Amaras, and why don't you go with that camera that is right on the front nose, so the furthest left of the options for your TV director controller? And right on the nose, we'll follow a little bit with Amaras, and we'll switch around as we watch here. This is the 24 hours of Kyoto Grand Prix long, and this is the speed up.
case you're just joining us, this is, you're watching the fourth round of the 2013 GT1 World Series, brought to you by New Dimension Racing. This is the 24 hours of Kyoto Grand Prix long. Our current leader is NX Racing, car number 13 in the Pro category, currently driven by Robin Friscott. Second place is Dominic Engel for Genuine Racing. Third place is Sean Liddon for Team Virus. Our amateur category leader is still Hellenic Racing Team in the FXR, which is 8th overall. Dig Breeding Program is 2nd in that category, 11th overall. And Matt Kingsbury is 3rd in the Last Lap Motorsports number 57 amateur car. We are 39 minutes from the halfway stage of the race, and we are 4 laps away from 300 laps on the board. And Robin Friscott actually has a rather healthy lead at present. It is about 40 seconds, 35 to 40 seconds, it's about 36.9 to be precise, over Dominic Engel, who in probably about 10 minutes time will be making his next pit stop. He's got 7.5 seconds ahead of Sean Liddon, and then hidden in the Terra Mine Factory FZR number 15 is a further 5 or so seconds back from Liddon.
Sorry if I'm not being too talkative, but I think you can understand that my primary obligation is to the actual administration of the race itself. And if I have measures to take care of to help keep that running smoothly, I think you can understand that I keep silent towards the stream for a little bit. But yeah, we've got about probably 20 minutes or so before the next set of auction stopping pit stops. A little less for some teams, a little longer for some other teams. Actually, Genuine Racing will be in soon. Is in right about now as Dominic Engel comes out of the final corners. Francois Maris connects to the server. Dom actually goes another lap. Looks like we'll have that first pit stop any moment now. And of course, Steve, as I'm sure you're well aware of, pit stop window means a chance for a few more punctures. Thank you. Car 58, the Virus Amp car, was in the gravel trap. Just briefly, they made their way out. I think that was in the turn 1 or 2 area.
Meanwhile, we are expecting Genuine Racing's angle to be pitting this time round. He's just at the final corner at the moment. Maurice, his teammate, is in the server and poised to take over. Indeed, he does come into the pits. Gotta be careful with that pit lane speed limit. It's 80 kilometers an hour, 50 miles an hour. He gets it down and is safe. He hits his marks. It's these little things that if you keep missing your marks occasionally throughout, you have just a slightly larger gap than you should have on something like a driver change. These little things do add up over 24 hours if it keeps occurring. You got to be careful every time you're making a stop. Just keep it as smooth as possible and make sure you're concentrating the whole time.
Well, you know, the difference between LFS and real life is, in real life, if you don't hit the marks, it takes time for your actual mechanics to reposition themselves based on where you did actually stop, but in LFS, that doesn't matter. As long as you stop within the sensored area, it will serve you, and it'll delay the time it takes you to stop and start back up.
Indeed, although we've seen a number of people today missing a pit box completely and having to either reverse back or drive on until the next car, which costs precious seconds each time. So Maurice is in the car now, and he's rejoined in 5th place.
Say that LLM has been fairly impressive this past season and a half, the half of the season so far, and the last GT2 World Series season. Quite a few of their drivers have improved, and also they've gotten some fresh new talent in that has helped improve their older talent.
Certainly, I mean, especially so with in the amateur category. I mean, you see, number 57 is currently running third there. I believe that, I think it was that entry that won the amateur category at West Hill last time around, if you recall. I think quite comfortably as well. But the pro car for LLM hasn't had quite as good a run as the AM car. Certainly the last couple of rounds I've noticed. And today it's right at 19th overall. It's 7 laps down in its class. But the AM car has been pretty damn good over recent times, and it's only third in the amateur category. I've got joining us in the commentary box now is Ray Kingsbury of Last At Most Sports. So, good, I guess it's the evening for you, Ray. How's the race going for the two LLM cars from your perspective?
Well, definitely could be better. Our pro car seems to have suffered engine damage in the first hour of the race, and it's actually gotten worse. I noticed it wasn't that bad this time around, maybe because of the lighter fuel load, but it's definitely killing our lap times. But we were turning some nice splits, and once we get to the last sector, it was dead. So we're just going to finish out the race and hope for some timeouts, and maybe we'll make up some spots. Our XR is doing pretty good, but unfortunately, one of our drivers has gone AWOL. He's supposed to drive these five stints that Matt's driving right now, and he's one of our faster drivers. So Matt's kind of improvising right now, and he has gotten in a couple incidents, hopefully to cost us too much time. But we should be able to maintain the amateur class podium here. And since it's a double points race, I believe, we should be able to move up a couple more spots in the overall and the amateur points, maybe into the top 10. And then we won't have to worry about prequal.
Indeed, it's a very important round with those double points, as you say. How frustrating is it to have the engine damage in a race this long? When about did it originate, or when did you start noticing it?
Well, Marus was complaining he was a second off of his pace a lap in his first stint of the race, so we think that something happened either on the safety car at the start, where somebody rear-ended us and it just revved the car up a little bit, or either that or just going into the Boothie chicane, he tried to outbrake somebody. Actually, we were in a three-wide battle with our teammate, and I think he slid the car a little bit, so I think he forgot to blip the throttle or something, or forgot to brake a little more, I don't know, but anyways, it was pretty messed up when I got in the car, and it wasn't awful, it wasn't terribly off pace. I managed to match Marius' best time, so I figured it was just him being a bad driver, because I'm actually one of the slower drivers on our team. But on my last stint, I noticed that it was pretty slow on the straightaways, but it could have been because of the 100% fuel load. But I really doubt it, because I was hearing from Joel, who actually was running 214s in practice, that it was pretty bad, and he only ran a 215 high by his stint. So something must have happened between my last stint and Pikel's stint. My first stint and Pikel's stint, because the only thing I could think of is maybe the incident between Core, which I protested. They got a penalty for it, but I spun around and I think I accidentally went into reverse. So I went from second to reverse. I'm not really sure if that messed anything up, but and I wasn't here for Patrick's stint, but obviously something happened between first and the third stint that really got it messed up. And we're just gonna kind of play with the fuel game here, and hopefully, since the car will be lighter and a little slower, we'll be able to make the tires last a little longer and make up some ground that way.
So is there anything that you can really do with the car when it's got engine damage like this, except just put up with it and try and make the best of it?
I mean, it's really handling well on the turns. That's a plus side to it. I don't think I ran off once. Maybe I ran off once on the last and from the slipstream or something. But our FCR is really not focused. We were just hoping to finish the race, have a decent result, have fun. Because actually this is William's first endurance race, I believe. I don't think he's ever drove in anything before, so he's actually doing quite well. And based off my last performance at Westo, I just wanted to get out there and show that I could not crash the car. And I've so far succeeded in that. I haven't taken anybody off, I don't think. And at Westo, I was just a complete mess. I got my probation, but hopefully this proves that I'm not as bad as I was then. And basically what happened at Westo was just all sorts of stuff went wrong on my end. Between the car, applications in the background, stuff like that, and I'd actually done like six stints of practice the day before for that, so I was really prepared and kind of pissed it didn't go better.
So when are you next going to be jumping in the car?
Yeah, I'll be alternating. Actually, I think I'm doing a double stint next, so I'm just going to be looking to finish that one out, and then Maru should jump on the car, and if he doesn't, I guess I'll do a triple stint, and then just give it off to him. And hopefully, we won't lose too much time. And then that'll be my last stint, because I won't be available tomorrow, but we should see. Hopefully our AM car will be able to get the faster drivers back in earlier, and we'll make up some spots, because with Matt in the car, we're losing quite a bit of time. His best lap so far is only a 2.16.9. Even I was turning better than that with engine damage, so. And he just repaired. He's probably going to get a couple penalties based on the protest threat I've seen. Hopefully not, because I was behind him when it happened, and I would say the incident could go either way, but yeah. Overtaking cars need to be a little bit more careful and not dive bomb and overshoot shit. But yeah. I guess you're bored, huh?
Looking ahead to beyond this race, to the rest of the year, what plans do LLM have for, with regards to other series on LFS and anything on other sims?
Well, we don't really have a strong basis in other sims. Matt and I do a little bit of racing in the NASCAR game, but nothing serious. Pretty much the competition there is a little lower than this, but there are people, you know, that are aliens. A couple guys were talking about R Factor, but I don't think that's going to happen. So, yeah, pretty much just LFS. And we got some new talent. Homo Jusula, he's been with us for a while. He finally just started doing league racing, and he's more of a hot lapper, but he's been doing a really good job on the endurance, and it's really surprising because he was always nervous to mess things up, so he wasn't driving for a couple of years. And then Remco Mahor, he got a new wheel, so he's like in the GTRs now. He was a big open wheel guy and was a little annoyed, but he's been doing a good job for us. And you know, we actually tried to qualify. Well, for the rest of the season, we're hoping, you know, to get into the top three for the overall AM cars, top 10 for the overall series. We kind of hindered ourselves. The XRR actually didn't make the second round, so we've only done 2 rounds with the XRR, and both results for those were pretty good. But we didn't make it to pre-qual at Firm Bay just because XRR was a lot slower than the FCR, and the FXR obviously was really fast. And then I think it was the only round where they had like something like 60 teams try to pre-qual through, so like a lot of people didn't make it. And yeah, so that cost us about, you know, like whatever, like we'll just say like 15 points, and that easily would have put us into the top 10 for the overall. And that's with assuming we would have done a low finishing position. And that was actually the race I was going to race, and I was only a 10th off the pre-qual time because our other drivers couldn't pre-qual for that weekend, so I was actually really excited for that race, but it never happened. I'm really surprised there have not been more cautions in this race, Steve. I've been looking at I've been watching the tracker for most of the part. Or most of the race, rather, and you know, not that many incidents. You know, we had one rollover.
Sorry to interrupt. Speaking of which, number 55, that's the A6 Motorsport car, just went for a spin in an 11, the spoon curve along left hander. It tapped the wall, but it's back going again. But yeah, it's been quite surprising. There's only been two safety cars so far. I mean, there's been a number of cars that have been rescued from the gravel, but the only one retirement so far, which is from the flip.
Yeah, we got lucky. We actually managed to roll our car over in the Boothie chicane. Not really sure how it happened. I guess some lag hit, but it was really no big deal. It didn't cause us any damage. Joe somehow landed on all four wheels and kept going. We got pretty lucky there, because, you know, we're just here to have fun, finish the race. Not really trying to get in anybody's way. And some people are a little bit more impatient than us, it seems, but because I'm watching people beat and bang, but I guess I don't realize that there's still 12 hours left in this race.
Indeed. Well, I don't believe you've been the only one to have rolled and managed to get away with it. I think there's been at least one other, there might have been two others. There's one I saw that looked like it had rolled, but there's been several of you who've...
Well, I just realized I have my window open for a whole hour now.
It's been unlucky, essentially.
Sorry, I had to close that. It's starting to freeze in here.
That's fine.
I find it amazing that some people from Great Britain are still driving because, or you know, Finland, because they've been up for like you know, probably 20 hours now unless they really slept in. For me, it's only 9:40 p.m. and I'm not going to race past 1 o'clock. If that happened, 1 o'clock is my latest. I'll probably be racing until 12 and then hopefully I won't have to race until 1. If I'm racing past 1, I'm disconnecting or DNFing. So, you know, simple as that.
Indeed, this is... It's one of the challenges of this sort of race, of course, how you manage the night racing and how you manage drives throughout that whole period.
I'm really surprised about how quick the race is going. I think this track, like Westell, seems like the laps were just never ending. You know, I was doing a stand, I'm like, well, this is taking forever. This track's quite fun for the FCR. And, you know, it's not a challenge to keep the tire heat down as much as it was for Westell. Much more enjoyable experience and actually enjoying the track. And I'm not, you know, turning good laps or anything, but I'm trying. And hopefully, we'll be able to finish. I mean, we're 7 laps down now, and you know, it could be better, it could be worse. I mean, think about it. It's already 12 and a half hours through the race, and we've only lost 7 laps. So it's less than a lap an hour. It's pretty good. Considering our FCR drivers are actually more amateur drivers. We have one pro driver, and then everybody else on that lineup is an AM driver. And most of them haven't really done much endurance racing, except for Marius and Pykel. You know, they're pretty quick, but, you know, they can't carry the whole team. And I'm actually really surprised by Fernandez, because his pedals were actually broken before the stint. The spring was broken, so he put an eraser behind his pedals, and, it seems like it's keeping it from falling over now.
Oh, it looks like your brother's been off at turn 9.
Yeah, I just heard it from Echo. Doesn't seem like it was anything bad, he hasn't lost much time.
Twice in 2 laps, I'm told. But,
yeah.
Seems to
have... At least he hasn't broken the car yet. He managed to do that like 6 times in the last stint.
Indeed, it's been quite fortunate to get away about how much damage you're getting stuck in the gravel.
Yeah, like I said, he was really only supposed to do 1 stint maximum. It was supposed to be a holding stint, but it looks like he's going to do 5. Until, you know, somebody wakes up. Luckily, Nathan did it past his bedtime, which was like 6 p.m. Did an hour. Poor Nathan's got to get his beauty sleep. I guess they're going to sit here and wait and see what the penalty is to that, because, well, there probably will be a penalty knowing his luck, but there's 2 protests against him. Hopefully it doesn't go too long to the point where, you know, there's a safety car or something and he has to serve after that safety car.
And then, meanwhile, we've got a battle for 6th place in pro and overall. It's the Conquest Pro Car. Barbalowski, and that's the exciting Team Sports pro car. That's strong.
The INX car is also in that picture, and that'll be interesting to see if they just wait it out or if they go for it here. I have a feeling Robin is going to play it safe, though. He's a pretty conservative driver.
And he's got a healthy lead as well, about 40 seconds-ish. So
yeah.
It's not really worth throwing that one.
Byers car got that drive-through penalty, and then they ran into the back of our AM car, actually, and caused themselves to spin out. No, they probably could be battling for the lead right now if they didn't have those misfortunes. And I believe they're not the only ones that got a drive-through penalty for speeding in the pits, which I don't really get how you do here, because you have that chicane you have to go through. That forces you to slow down, unless they're accelerating and trying to break at the last second, but It's a pretty dumb thing to do.
Indeed, there's been a couple of other.
Like even the NX got one.
Yeah, the NX car got a drive-through on the first stop on the 1 hour mark.
Yeah, that's right, and I think Conquest did on the first stop as well, if I'm not mistaken. Them all driving.
And Chong has made the move into turn one and made it stick. It's up to sixth place overall.
I was really surprised that there weren't more cars trying to pre-qual into this race, because usually when there's a 24-hour race, there's a huge waiting list, and, you know, it is a series, but still, they were basically inviting everybody who wanted to come and race, and it seems that we didn't even have a full grid, which is kind of surprising, but, you know, when you think about it, it's actually better that way, because it keeps cars off of each other, and, you know, it gives you more room, less cars die bombing. Especially when you get those guys that are, you know, just the ringers, and they're just here to run that one race, because, you know, for fun. Whatever, you know, they don't have anything to risk in the points, however they do have, you know, a reason to win it. And if they take somebody else out, you know, take themselves out of the race, they're thinking, oh, no loss, but, you know, other cars that are championship contenders get pretty pissed. But, so I think we're lucky we don't have any cars like that. We had one, I think, which ended up taking itself out early on by flipping the Amarita car, but I think they'd been signed up for the season, this series before then.
Yes, I believe so. Yes, one of the troubles was with having a longer race like this is you need more drivers typically to be able to do the race properly. I mean, we see NX and Genuine Racing, for example, they have two full season cars, but they've only brought one. They've not had the resources to field second cars. And I believe. You guys usually have the bus.
Yeah, we usually have three, but we actually aren't using any of those drivers except for Dalba. And he was going to drive XR anyways, but yeah, they didn't want to drive this round because they're all Lithuanian, and they felt that, you know, it'd just be ridiculous for one of them, especially for an FXR, because they wouldn't really be competitive, and they're all beginners. But yeah, we had trouble finding people for FCR, actually, so we had to add Fernandez at the last second, and we had to add a guest driver, which is actually quite a benefit because he's really quick. And I'm going to be driving a double stint in 10 minutes, so I'm going to go prepare for that, and it was nice talking to you, though.
Okay, thank you for joining us, right, and best of luck for the rest of the race.
Yeah, I'm going to need it.
While you're doing that interview, I was kind of doing some admin things and looking through the field, Steve. And you can tell we're definitely getting close to some more pit stops. If I'm not correct, what say you? This is a good time to do a quick break in the stream since it's coming up to the top of the hour.
Yes, I'd say so. Get out of the way before the pit stops come along.
So we will take just a short pause. Stay with us. The stream should automatically pop back up very quickly. You are watching the GT1 World Series 24 Hours of Kettering Grand Prix Long. Here on SimRace TV.